Hello, and welcome to another episode of the Machine Learning Essentials series, where we talk about some fundamental concepts of machine learning in the cloud. I'm Nishant Tucker, and in this video, we'll talk about model deployment and inferencing. But first, what do you mean by model deployment? Well, once data scientists create machine learning models, these models need to be put to use. Now, a crude way to do that would be to rewrite the model in the same language or framework your app or your analytic solutions are designed in and embed the model as a function or a subroutine inside of it. Although it is possible, but would require a complete rewrite every time a new version of the model is made available. The more scalable and definitely the more preferred way is to package the model and host it as a web service endpoint to be called as needed. This call to the web service endpoint is what we refer to as an inference call. Now, what this allows us to do is to create models and frameworks or languages that are best suited for these and keep a microservice architecture for scale and flexibility. Now, there are a few concepts to understand for scalable deployment and inferencing. First, inference modes. Second, deployment topologies. Third, deployment infrastructure. And fourth, inference optimization options. Let's understand these one by one. First, the inference modes. When we talk about making inference calls to a model, what we are really doing is sending some data for the model to analyze and send back as a response, usually in the form of a prediction, classification, or segmentation exercise. We can send these requests to the model in two forms. Either send a request for every data point or tuple to get a response for each one, or send a batch of data tuples to the model, and the system can score and store them in a data store. These are exactly the two inference modes. The first one, where we send individual tuples as inference requests, is used mostly in scenarios where the model is warranted to respond in real time. And thus, we call it real-time inferencing. And second, where we send a pointer to the location of the batch of data and expect to see a scored data set as output once the entire batch is analyzed and inferenced upon. Since it's a batch being inferenced upon, we call it batch inferencing. There are different applications and, as a result, considerations for each of these inferencing modes. Real-time inferencing, for example, is used in scenarios where low latency is extremely crucial. Either a user or an automated system at the other end is waiting to make a decision based on the inference output. Thus, it is important to design a deployment that can support very low latency. Examples of these include real-time personalization, predictive maintenance, and many more. On the other hand, for batch inferencing, latency may not be as important, but these could involve heavier pre-processing on the data and more time-consuming model processing requirements. Thus, the need for these are more towards automation and orchestration. Examples of these include sales forecasting, customer churn prediction, and many more. Now let's talk about deployment topologies. For models to be deployed as an endpoint, you need the following components. First, you need an environment. This environment encapsulates the dependencies required to run your model for inference. Second, you need scoring code. This is a script that accepts requests, scores the requests by using the model, and returns the results. Third, you need inference configurations. The inference configuration specifies the environment, the entry script, and other components needed to run the model as a service. These are all placed into a base container image, which becomes the execution environment for the model. The container image has a load-balanced HTTP endpoint that receives scoring requests that are sent to the web service. Now, this process can happen in three different ways. First, we can use no-code deployment, where you use UI capabilities to let Azure Machine Learning containerize the model with all of its dependencies and deploy it for you. This is mostly used when you deploy models created using Azure Machine Learning Designer capabilities or the automated machine learning capabilities within Azure ML. The second way to do this is to use system images. where you leverage the Azure Machine Learning SDK to utilize a base container provided by Azure Machine Learning to deploy the model into. This base container comes with the most common dependencies like Conda environments, the latest frameworks, etc., to make containerization process much simpler and faster. This is used when deploying models created in Azure Machine Learning using the code-first options like notebooks and VS Code. The third is you can bring your own containers. This is for more advanced deployments where you may be using custom frameworks developed in-house or need to maintain tighter control over component versions. In this topology, you create your own custom base image with all the software and dependencies required by your model. Now, depending on your needs and expertise, you can deploy models using any of the container topologies above. The next question that arises is, where do you deploy these containers? That is what we'll discuss as part of deployment infrastructure. Again, depending on the stage of deployment, you can choose from a variety of options. First, you can have a local web service. This is mostly used while you're testing and troubleshooting your deployment packages on your local machines. Second, you can have Azure Container Instances. Again, mostly recommended for a dev test environment. This is used to validate the containerized deployments before moving them into full-scale production. It is mostly for low-scale CPU-only deployments. Third, the Azure Kubernetes Service, or AKS. This is the preferred deployment environment for production workloads that require real-time inferencing. Given it's a fully managed Kubernetes environment, it can scale to your needs from tens to thousands of nodes for very high queries per second requirements. It supports both CPU and GPU-based deployments, offering even more flexibility for low latency response times. And the fourth is the Azure Machine Learning Compute Clusters. Yes, these are the same clusters we discussed in the model training video too. These can also be used to deploy models. This option is only for batch inferencing needs. It supports both CPU and GPU-based deployments with an option for low-priority VMs. As we discuss various compute environments, we should rest assured that all production-ready compute environments like the Azure Kubernetes Service and the Azure Machine Learning Compute Clusters come with enterprise-grade monitoring, security, and governance. These support both key-based and token-based authentication for secure inferencing requests. These can be configured inside VNets if needed. And these integrate with Azure App Insights for granular information about what's happening inside these environments. In addition to the ones above, Azure Machine Learning is also previewing a new managed endpoint. This is designed to take away any administration and upkeeping of the AKS or the Azure Machine Learning compute clusters, even for production workloads. It can work for both real-time inferencing workloads with online endpoints and batch inferencing workloads with batch endpoints. With managed endpoints, you just provide your deployment configuration, like the model path and version, alongside the compute instance definition in the form of a YAML file. And Azure Machine Learning takes care of setting up the compute, deploying the model with all of its dependencies specified, and maintaining this compute environment on your behalf with auto-scaling capabilities built in. These managed endpoints also support managed identities, whether they are system-managed or user-managed, stored in key vault or blob storage. Managed endpoints can recognize them and authorize inference requests appropriately. In due course, these would also support VNets with private IP so that customers can completely log these endpoints to their VNets. Please explore these managed endpoints and share any feedback you may have with us. We've talked a lot about inferencing, but haven't yet explored what optimization options are available. Optimizations can happen at two levels. First, at the model and frameworks level, and second, at the hardware level. To understand optimization, it is important to first understand the baseline deployment architecture itself. For example, a deployment to Azure Kubernetes Service or Azure Container Instance by default uses a single-threaded, general-purpose web framework. Multiple Flask worker nodes are started to concurrently handle incoming requests. These workers handle pre-processing tasks like featureization, calling the model.run method, and then any post-processing tasks like aggregation, etc. And these are framework agnostic. To optimize these inference requests with GPU-based hardware, one can use Triton. Triton is a framework that is optimized for inferencing. It provides better utilization of GPUs and more cost-effective inferencing. On the server side, it batches incoming requests and submits these as batches for inference instead of the individual tuples. Batching better utilizes GPU resources and is a key part of Triton's performance. With Triton, the inference configuration deployment looks like this. Multiple workers are started to concurrently handle incoming requests. The requests are forwarded to a Triton server. Triton processes requests and batches to maximize GPU utilization, and all this happens with no change required on the client side, as the client still uses the same Azure ML scoring URI to make these requests. Here's a pro tip. Triton should be a no-brainer for high-frequency inferencing workloads. It will help you take advantage of GPUs better and automatically improve throughput of your deployment. Further optimizing machine learning models on framework or the model side is difficult, since you need to tune the model and the inference libraries to make the most of the hardware capabilities. The problem becomes extremely hard if you want to get optimal performance on different kinds of platforms, like cloud and the edge, CPU or GPU-based architectures, etc., since each one has different capabilities and characteristics. The complexity increases even further if you have models from a variety of frameworks that need to run on a variety of platforms. It's very time-consuming to optimize all the different combinations of frameworks and hardware. This is where Onyx comes in. Microsoft and a community of partners created Onyx, which is an open standard for representing machine learning models. Models from many frameworks, including PyTorch, TensorFlow, scikit-learn, Keras, Chainer, MXNet, MATLAB, and SparkML, can be exported or converted to the standard Onyx format. Once the models are in the Onyx format, they can be run on a variety of platforms and devices with the Onyx runtime. This Onyx runtime is a high-performance inference engine for deploying Onyx models to production. It's optimized for both the cloud and the edge and works on Linux, Windows, and Mac. Onyx runtime supports both DNNs and traditional ML models and integrate with accelerators on different hardware, such as TensorRT on NVIDIA GPUs, OpenVINO on Intel processors, DirectML on Windows, and many more. By using Onyx runtime, you can benefit from extensive production-grade optimizations, testing, and ongoing improvements. Here's a pro tip. If you're looking at deploying models to IoT Edge, Onyx comes in handy with its ecosystem of device partners to enable Onyx runtime compatibility. Well, this went really deep really quickly. Let's recap. We discussed two inference modes, real-time and batch. Both have specific needs and uses. Then, we discussed three deployment topologies: no-code-based deployment, system image-based deployment, and bring-your-own-container-based deployment. We also discussed compute targets: local compute, Azure Container Instances, Azure Kubernetes Service, Azure Machine Learning Compute Clusters, and the newly introduced Managed Endpoints. Finally, we looked at optimization options like Triton and Onyx. I hope this gave you a clear view of the deployment landscape for machine learning models at scale. To try these out, please spin up a free Azure Machine Learning workspace at aka.ms/aml-trial and download a 30-day learning journey from the Data Scientist Resources page at aka.ms/data-scientists. That's it for this video. See you in another episode of the Machine Learning Essentials series. Thank you.